Welcome everyone to the 9th lecture on representations of finite groups. Today we are going to discuss group actions and permutation representations. We already defined what a group action is right in lecture 1. Let me recall for you. So let G be a group and X a set. Then an action of G on X is a group homomorphism sigma from G to S of X, where Sx is the group of all bijections of X. Sx is the symmetric group on the set X. Symmetric group on the set X, the set of all bijections of the set X, right? Now, what we are going to see is how a given action of a group on a set gives rise to representations. And those representations will be called permutation representations, since they arise from the permutation group of a set X on which your group acts. So before proceeding further, let us discuss some ideas about actions, group actions, which we have not talked about so far. So what is a transitive action? This idea is going to play a major role in this lecture. So an action is said to be transitive. An action of G on a set X is called transitive if given two elements X and Y of the set X, there is a group element which map one to the other. If X and Y in the set X, there exists a G in the group G such that sigma G of X is your Y. Okay? For example, the regular action of a group on itself is transitive. You can consider left or right regular, whichever you like. So the map sigma from G to S of G given by sigma G. Now it has to be a permutation of the set G. It acts on any H as simply GH for all G and H in the group G. Okay, so this is clearly transitive. Right? Given, let us say X and Y in the group G, take G to be X inverse Y, then we see that sigma G of Y, which is GY by definition, is same as XY inverse Y, that is X. So therefore, left translation of a group on itself is always a transitive action, similarly right translation. So there are plenty of transitive actions. We can extend this idea and talk about what we call a two transitive action, or in general a K transitive action. So a K transitive action. So let sigma from G to S of X be an action of a group G on a set X. We say that the action is K transitive if given two k tuples of elements, if given two k tuples of distinct elements, say x1, x2, so on, xk, and y1, y2, so on, yk, of your set X, there exists a group element G in G such that G sigma G of xi is yi for every I from 1 to k. And if k is 2, it is 2 transitive, which is going to be play a crucial role in today's lecture. Let us consider an example. Let Sn be the symmetric group on n symbols. Then Sn act on the set, let us call it X tilde, consisting of symbols 1, 2, 3, 4 up to n. You take any permutation in Sn and then you just permute these elements according to that permutation, according to the labeling. My claim is that Sn action on X tilde is then k transitive for each k between 1 and n. So for that, you take 2 k tuples of distinct elements from this X tilde. Let us call them x1, x2, xk and y1, y2, yk. So let us define this new set X to be 1 to n minus the elements from the first tuple and y to be 1 to n minus element from the second tuple. Notice that cardinality of X is n minus k, which is same as cardinality of Y. They are finite sets of same order, so there is a bijection between them. Let us call that bijection to be alpha. Now define this permutation in Sn by this following rule. So tau of any m, okay, is just yi if your m is xi and alpha of m otherwise. Then alpha is the desired permutation which maps the first k tuple to the second k tuple. In other words, the permutation tau maps xi to yi for each I simultaneously by the same group element. Okay, and that is the permutation tau. Let us develop this further. So given an action of a group, given an action sigma from G to Sx of G on a set X, one can define an action of the group G on Cartesian product of X with itself. We can define an action, let me denote it by sigma k, from where? From G to the symmetric group on x to the power k, okay, where x to the power k is a k-fold Cartesian product, x times x times times x. By the rule, so it's a diagonal action. So you take sigma k, okay, and it will take a group element, it will act on a tuple. So x1, x2, so on, xk, and the way it acts is just like sigma g will act on xi. So it is sigma g acting on x1, sigma g acting on x2, and so on, sigma g acting on xk. One can easily check that it's an action. Specializing to the case k equal to 2, the orbits of the action sigma 2 from G to symmetric group on X plus S are called orbitals, and they are going to play a role later on in our study of permutation representations associated to an action. So notice that the diagonal delta, which consists of xx, says that x is in x, is always an orbital provided the action is transitive. Right? Because if the action is transitive, given two element x and y, there is a group element such that sigma g of x is y. Therefore, xx can be written as sigma g of y, comma sigma g of y, that is sigma 2 of yy, right? So this is called the trivial orbital. This always exists as long as your action is transitive. So we can now prove this proposition. Let sigma from g to sx be an action of a group g on a set x such that cardinality is bigger than or equal to 2, which we assume just to avoid triviality. Then there is this nice criteria for true transitivity of the action in terms of orbitals. It says that sigma is true transitive if and only if sigma is transitive and the number of orbitals is 2. Okay. First, notice that every true transitive action is obviously transitive. Okay, this is a direct check. And because the action is transitive, therefore the diagonal is an orbital. So to prove the forward implication, if I can show that the complement is also an orbital, then I am done. So consider x cross x minus a diagonal. Okay. Now since the action is two transitive, if I take two points in x cross x minus a diagonal, that is two tuples of distinct elements, xy and x prime y prime in x cross x, where x not equal to y and x prime not equal to y prime. Since the action is two transitive, there is a group element such that sigma 2g of xy is same as x prime y prime, which is same equivalent to saying that sigma g of x equal to x prime and sigma g of y equal to y prime. Okay, therefore the complement of the diagonal in x cross x is also an orbit of the action sigma 2 and hence an orbital. The converse is also similar. Conversely, if the action is transitive, that means the diagonal is always an orbital. And if I am saying there are two orbitals, but the orbitals are disjoint, that means the complement of the diagonal is also an orbital. But this calculation shows that that is equivalent to showing that the action is two transitive. This completes the proof of the proposition. We can now define what are called permutation representations. Let sigma from g to sx be an action of a group g on a set x. Then using this action, we are going to construct a representation of g. That will be the permutation representation associated to sigma. So what we do is the following. We compose sigma with the standard representation of the symmetric group sx into glv, okay, where v is a complex vector space of dimension n. And if you want, we can identify it with a vector space, abstract vector space spanned by the set X. So therefore, sigma composed with the map from SX to this gives you a representation of G called the permutation representation of G associated to sigma. In other words, if you want to be precise, the permutation representation sigma is the representation, let us call it sigma tilde, from G to GLV, where V is the abstract vector space spanned by X, given by the following. So sigma tilde of a group element will act on vectors in V, and vectors in V are C linear combination of elements of X, summation cxx, x is in your set x, we are assuming all of our sets to be finite. This is just by definition is summation cx, an action of this group element on x, sigma g of x. Notice that sigma an action, so sigma g will act on x, so that's this action as you vary x in x. If you want, after doing change of variable, you can write it as summation C of sigma g inverse of y into y, and as you vary y in x. Alright, this is the permutation representation associated to the permutation sigma. In case your action sigma is the left regular action of g on itself, then this is what is called the regular representation that we already discussed. So therefore, permutation representation can be thought of as generalizations of regular representations where the set on which the group is acting is any other set, not necessarily the group itself. So the aim of this lecture is to understand permutation representations and find out conditions for finding irreducible factors of permutation representations. Write it as a remark. If sigma from G to S of G is the regular action, okay, the usual left multiplication of G on itself, then sigma tilde is the regular representation. Okay, that we already discussed. Here is a proposition. Let sigma from G to Sx be an action of a group G on a set X, then the permutation representation, then sigma tilde from G to GLV, where V is the vector space spanned by X, is a unitary representation. So I'm not going to prove this. The proof is exactly the same as what we did for regular representation. Recall that we showed that the regular representation is always unitary. It's exactly the same proof. So the inner product that we give on GLV is just the Hermitian inner product of the coefficients. So what can we say about the characters of permutation representations? It turns out that they have a very nice description in terms of fixed points. So proposition. Let sigma from G to Sx be an action, of G on a set X. Then the character of the permutation representations sigma tilde at a group element G is precisely the number of fixed points of G. In particular, in this case, the character turns out to be real valued. So proof. So recall that, what is a fixed point of an element? Recall that if G belongs to group G, then sigma of G is an Sx, is a permutation of this. It's a bijection of X. So one can talk about the fixed point of this, and the fixed point set of G is defined as all those X in X such that sigma G of X is just X, the usual definition. Okay, let's try to figure out the character. To recall that the character is a trace, so we need to see how the matrix look like. So fix a basis. So let X equals to say x1, x2, so on, let us say xn. So then this X is also a basis for the underlying vector space of the permutation representation sigma tilde. Then X is an ordered basis, for the representation space V of sigma tilde. And if for any G in the group G, sigma G is, let us denote this bracket, denote the matrix of sigma G with respect to x, then we can find out the entry. Then we know that sigma g, this matrix and its igth entry is given by the following. Okay, just by definition it turns out that this is 1 if xi is sigma g of xj and 0 otherwise. Why this is the case? Notice that here the representation sigma tilde is coming from this action. Okay, and the action is a permutation of the basis element. So here each basis will go to just another basis. It will not go to a non-trivial linear combination. It will just go to another basis, right? And therefore sigma ijth entry of this will be non-trivial only if the xijth basis is the image of the xjth basis under j, and there will not be any coefficient anywhere else. So that's it. In particular, what are the diagonal entries? Ii are going to be 1 if xi equals to sigma g of xi and 0 otherwise. Okay, but you see, I am asking for fixed points. So, therefore, what is going to be chi of sigma tilde of g? This by definition is trace of this matrix sigma g, right? And which is by definition summation of sigma g I from 1 to n in this case, and that is going to be counting the number of 1s. Okay, and the 1s are precisely the number of fixed points from the basis. Okay, so that is the fixed point set of the group element G or sigma G is cardinality. So this proves the proposition. A very nice description of character in terms of the group, the action of the group on the set X. Okay. Notice here that if we would have taken action of the group G on itself by left multiplication, in that case, for any non-trivial element G of the group G, there won't be any fixed points. Therefore, the character of the regular representation in that case at a non-trivial element will be 0. And at a trivial element, we always know, it's a general fact, that it is precisely a degree of the representation, which is n here. So therefore, you get back the earlier result for regular representation of a group. Let us give one definition. Let phi from G to GLW be a representation of a group G. Then one can define what is called the fixed subspace of G or fixed subspace of the representation space W. We denote it by W superscript G, and that consists of all those vectors in W which are fixed by every group element under the representation or under the action. It's trivial to check that W superscript G is a linear subspace of W, and we call it the fixed subspace of G. All right. So the dimension of this fixed subspace can be found easily by this proposition. So let phi from G to GLB be a representation of the group G, and let chi 1 be the trivial character of G. Recall that every group admit a trivial character, okay, which is the trivial homomorphism from G into C star. Then the dimension of the fixed point space as a complex vector space is just given by the inner product of the character of phi with this trivial character. So let's do it. So we know by Mashke's theorem that every representation is a direct sum of irreducible representations, possibly with multiplicities. In particular, chi 1 will possibly appear there with some multiplicity. So we can write our representation space W as say M1 W1, direct sum M2 W2, direct sum MH WS, where each WI is an irreducible G invariant subspace of W. That means WI doesn't have a proper G invariant subspace. And let phi I be the restriction of I on WI, which are the irreducible constituents of your representation phi. So without loss of generality, we can assume that phi 1 stands for the trivial character chi 1. Okay, So now, since W is this direct sum, every vector in W has a unique representation as a vector from this plus vector from this plus vector from this. So for each vector W in small w in capital W, we can write it as W1 plus W2 plus so on plus WS, where little wi belong to this ith sum, miwi. Recall here that miwi is just the direct sum of mi copies of wi. So now let us evaluate the representation on this vector. So phi subscript g of w can be written as, because then phi is a direct sum of phi 1 plus phi 2 plus so on phi s. Okay, and note that phi I will act trivially on wj, right? So therefore you will be left with only this expression, which is m1 copies of phi 1 at g will act on w1 and so on, ms copies of phi s at g will act on the vector ws, right? But phi 1 is a trivial character, it acts trivially, so it is just the vector w1. All right, plus m2 of phi 2 w2, ms phi s of ws. All right, now let's observe now when this vector, an arbitrary vector of w, will lie in the fixed subspace w superscript g. So w will lie in w superscript g if and only if this expression is same as again w, which is same as little w1 plus little w2 plus little ws. But notice that this sum is direct. Therefore, every vector has a unique representation. Okay, so that implies that w will be fixed by the group if and only if each of its summand is fixed. That means little wi belong to mi wi to the power g for every I from 2 to s onward. Okay, therefore that is equivalent to saying that the fixed subspace can be written as m1 w1 plus m2, and the fixed subspace of w2 under g, and ms copies of fixed subspace of ws under g. Okay, but now we know that the fixed subspace for any representation is a g invariant subspace of the group, right? Just by definition it is g invariant. So therefore each of these wi of g is a g invariant subspace of wi, but we know they are irreducible. Therefore these g invariant subspaces have to be either trivial or whole of the wi's. But if, for example, let us say if w2 to the power g is same as w2, what does that mean? That means that the representation phi 2 is actually a trivial representation, that is it is a direct sum of this trivial characters. But that's not true, because we have already separated out the trivial character, all the copies of the trivial character in phi 1 here, right? And these are all possible inequivalent irreducible representations. Therefore the only possibility is that each of these wig has to be trivial. Okay, each of these wig has to be trivial for I bigger than or equal to 2 and less than or equal to s. Therefore w superscript g has to be only the first copy, which is m1 copies of w1. But notice that w1 is the representation space of the trivial character, which is one dimensional. Therefore dimension of w superscript g is just this multiplicity m1, okay, which is a multiplicity of the trivial character in the representation phi. But we know how to figure out multiplicity of a irreducible factor in a given representation. Just take the inner product of the character of the given representation with the character of that irreducible constituent. Therefore m1 is just chi of I inner product chi of 1, and thus dimension of w superscript g is given by this inner product. Let us compute the fixed subspace for the permutation representation now. So we write it in this proposition. Let sigma from g to sx be an action of a group G on a set X. Okay, so once you have an action of a group G on a set X, you have the orbits, and orbits of an action partition your set into pairwise disjoint equivalence classes, right? So let O1, O2, and so on, OM be the orbits of this action okay, and let me recall for you that they will the disjoint union will be your set X. All right, define VI to be summation of X as X belong to the orbit OI. Then the set V1, V2 and Vm is the basis for the fixed point subspace of the corresponding permutation representation, is a basis for Vg where V is a representation space of the associated permutation representation sigma tilde. Okay, so in particular, in this case, it implies that dimension of the fixed point space of a permutation representation is same as number of orbits of the group action. So let's prove it. So before showing that this set V1 to Vm is a basis for the fixed point subspace, we need to show that they are actually fixed, right? So consider sigma tilde G acting on one of those VIs. That by definition is sigma G tilde acting on summation of X, where X belong to an orbit, let us say OI here in this case. And this, by definition of the permutation representation, this is summation sigma G of X, where X belong to OI. Okay, so now if you have an orbit of an action and you again multiply the group elements, it will still remain in the same orbit. So this is again same as summation of Y, where Y belong to the orbit OI, which is just your VI. Okay, so hence the set V1, V2, so on Vm is indeed a subset of the fixed point subspace of the representation sigma tilde. Okay, we will show that it is in fact an orthonormal set in Vg. So consider the inner product. Consider inner product of Vi with Vj. Okay, but we can check directly that this is simply order of Oi if I is j and zero otherwise. The reason being simple, because Vi is a certain sum of vectors in one orbit and Vj is certain sum of vectors in other orbit, and if you take the inner product, which is the standard Hermitian inner product here of their coefficient, okay, so because they do not, orbits are disjoint, so they do not have anything in common if I is different from j, and if I is j, then they are actually the same vector, and therefore the inner product is just sum of one square, so one for each element of the orbit, which implies that the set V1, V2, Vm is orthogonal and hence linearly independent. Okay. So we have found a linearly independent subset of our fixed subspace V superscript G to show that the set V1, V2, Vm is a basis for the fixed subspace V superscript G, it remains to show that it spans V superscript G. Okay, so take a vector V in V superscript G, the fixed subspace. Okay, so it lies in V, but V is the abstract vector space spanned by the set X. Therefore, V can be written as certain linear combination of elements of X, some CXX, where X is in X. Okay, all right. So now observe the following. Because V is fixed, therefore V should be same as sigma G tilde of V for every G, right? In particular, we have summation CXX, X in X should be same as summation CX, sigma G of X, X in X. So keep note of this. My claim is that if I collect all X in X which are in single orbit, then the corresponding coefficient CX are the same. Okay, that is, if two elements of X are in the same orbit, their coefficients as they appear in V, they are the same. Why that is the case? So let us say, suppose that Z and Y are in the same orbit. That means there is a group element G such that sigma G of Y is Z. All right. Now in this expression, look at the coefficient of Z on the left hand side. The coefficient of Z on the left hand side is going to be CZ. Whereas the coefficient of Z on the right hand side, because sigma G Y become Z, so the coefficient of Z on the right hand side is going to be CY, which implies CZ equal to CY. So therefore, if two elements of X are in the same orbit, their coefficients as they appear in the expansion of V should be the same. So therefore, if V is CXX as X is in X, I can rewrite it as some I from 1 to M, and now I put them in blocks of the orbits. Summation CXX and X is in orbit OI. Okay, but I know that all the coefficients of all the vectors X which lie in the same orbit are the same. So all these CX are the same for X is in OI. Let us call them as DI. So I can write it as summation I from 1 to M DI times summation X as X is in OI. But summation X as X is in the orbit OI is just the vector VI. So that is same as summation DI VI I from 1 to M. Thus, given a fixed point of the representation, of the permutation representation, I have been able to write it as a linear combination of these bases VI. Okay, so this shows that the dimension or the fixed space of the permutation representation associated to an action sigma is precisely the number of orbits under the action. Very interesting result. In particular, if your action is transitive, that is the group has one orbit, in that case, the dimension of the fixed space is just one. Let's write a consequence of the preceding proposition. If sigma from G to SX is a transitive action, that is the action has only one orbit, then dimension of the fixed space of the permutation representation associated to sigma is precisely one. In fact, we know a non-zero vector which is fixed by the permutation representation, namely take V0 to be summation X as X is in X. Okay, it is clearly fixed by the permutation representation associated to sigma, and hence the fixed point, fixed subspace is precisely the vector subspace spanned by this V0. Let us derive another interesting consequence of preceding proposition called Burnside's lemma. Let sigma from G to SX be an action of a group G on a set X, and let us say M be the number of orbits of this action. Then the lemma says that the number of orbits M is given by this average. Take the sum of fixed points of the group element and divide by order of the group. This follows immediately from the result that we proved in this lecture. So let chi1 be the trivial character of your group G. Then today we showed that for any representation, the dimension of the fixed space is same as the inner product of character of the representation with the trivial character. Okay, but the inner product of character of representation with trivial character gives precisely the multiplicity of that trivial character as a constituent of the given representation. All right. At the same time, in the preceding proposition, we showed that dimension of the fixed space is same as the number of orbits. Therefore, the number of orbits m is same as dimension of the fixed space, which is same as multiplicity of the trivial character in the representation, which is the permutation representation here. And now we apply the formula for this inner product in the group algebra, which is 1 by order of the group G, summation G in G, chi of sigma tilde of G and chi 1 of G bar. But note that chi 1 is a trivial character, so it is just 1. And therefore it is summation 1 by G and chi sigma tilde of G. But today we also computed character of the permutation representation. It is simply the number of fixed points of that group element G. So which is 1 by order of the group G, summation number of fixed points of the group element G. This proved Burnside's lemma. Let's write an interesting consequence of Burnside's lemma. Let sigma from G to Sx be a transitive group action. Then the number of orbitals is same as 1 by order of the group G and summation over little g in G, number of fixed point of G square, and which is same as the inner product of the character of the permutation representation associated to sigma with itself. Okay, let's prove it. So given an action sigma, we have this induced two-fold diagonal action sigma 2 from G to symmetric group on X cross X. Okay, now by Burnside's lemma, the number of orbits of this action, which is same as the number of orbitals, is same as 1 by order of the group G, summation G in G, and cardinality of fixed point of G. Okay, but notice here that this fixed point of G here means with respect to the two-fold diagonal action. Okay, so maybe I should write here with respect to sigma 2. But the number of fixed point of G with respect to sigma 2 is same as the fixed point of G with respect to sigma fixed point of G with respect to sigma. Therefore, you get this square. It's a direct check because the action is just diagonal. All right. And for the second equality, consider this inner product chi of sigma tilde with itself. This by definition is 1 by order of the group G, summation G in G, chi sigma tilde of G into chi sigma tilde of G bar. But we know that character of the permutation representation is simply the number of fixed points. So it becomes fixed points of G square. Okay. And here it is, of course, if you want to be clear, it is with respect to the action sigma. You might be wondering that I have not used that transitivity hypothesis of the action sigma here. And this has been put just to ensure that there is at least one orbital, namely the trivial orbital. This finishes the proof of the corollary. I will stop here, and in the next lecture, we will begin with discussing irreducible representations of the symmetric group S4. Thank you.